I would like to thank all of you for taking the time and coming down here and joining us. I really feel quite honored that we have got within our community a huge number of people, obviously many of them not here, who actually understand the importance of standing for justice and being the voice and the supporters of people who have got no one else to support them. And I think during the course of the evening, we will go through not just the entertainment and sort of being educated on what is important to stand up for justice, but also I think it's we need to celebrate. We need to celebrate the fact that at the time when things are so difficult for Muslims, we do have shining examples of those who stand up against all form of injustice, despite the fact that it's really unpopular. It is extremely unpopular these days to actually be champions of justice and champions of those who are oppressed. And I think from that point of view, we need to celebrate this. And I promise everybody that I'm not going to take the night dream speech. All I want to say is thank you very much. Enjoy yourself. And I hope that we all will take something back to make us more active and more willing to stand up for what is wrong. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه اللهم لا سهل إلا ما جعلته سهلا وأنت تجعل الحزن إذا شئت سهلا. Brothers, sisters and friends, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Thank you, brother, for that odd introduction that I'm not so used to. There was a question that I'm asked often about stand-up comedians, and they say that why are there no stand-up comedians in the Muslim community? And I say, of course, you're wrong, there are stand-up comedians in the Muslim community. They're all in Parliament. I have a history with the Islamic Human Rights Commission that goes back well before the time when I was in Guantanamo. And that was primarily to do with my father. My father talks about, very clearly, the people who assisted him in his campaign to bring justice for the Guantanamo prisoners, and primarily, of course, for his son, myself. And he says, quite openly and clearly, that although there were many non-Muslim organizations and individuals that helped, there were very few Muslim ones. And he says that with a sense of sadness, not with a sense of anger or bitterness. And one of the organizations, or the main Muslim organization that he's mentioned, that was helping and assisting and was there every leg of the journey, was the Islamic Human Rights Commission, as headed by Masoud Shajari. And that is also indicative of what the Muslim community here in the UK has become, despite the IHRC working on these issues for years on end, well before many of you might even have heard of them. The IHRC was working on issues regarding human rights and justice for the Muslim community. You can see quite clearly here that there's a signature image of Guantanamo Bay. And it will probably be ingrained in the minds of people, a collective history, for years, decades on end. And there were people who stood with the Guantanamo prisoners when it was not chic, when it was not fashionable to do so, when it was in fact better to keep away from them, to say that these guys are, quote unquote, the worst of the worst. They are suspected terrorists. They are probably part of Al-Qaeda or the Taliban or both. Therefore, let's not give them the benefit of the doubt. After all, if the United States of America and the United Kingdom and a plethora of countries from the Western so-called civil rights world have aided and abetted the establishment of Guantanamo Bay, the secret prisons, secret rendition and torture, then surely they couldn't have all got it wrong. So why give them the benefit of the doubt? Indeed, I was told on the day that I was returning from Guantanamo there was one Muslim Imam who gave a khutbah, a well-known Muslim Imam. And in his khutbah, he said, these people who are returning from Guantanamo, chains and shackles, don't show them any sympathy. They do not deserve the benefit of the doubt. Because they are bona fide terrorism suspects. The United States would not have held them for this long for no legitimate reason. And as time went on, as Guantanamo then became fashionable, as people started jumping on the bandwagon of Guantanamo to say that yes, we too want to get involved in this issue and campaign for those people, and indeed famous legal rights organizations around the world and legal groups were taking on bona fide and pro bono cases, the attitude towards Guantanamo changed to the point where now Great Britain, under Cameron, has ordered an inquiry unprecedented in the history of this country into the affairs of British intelligence and the complicity of British officials in the torture of British citizens. And before that, again unprecedented, in the cases of some Guantanamo prisoners, people, the police in particular, was ordered to investigate the actions of MI5. And so the attitudes towards Guantanamo started to change. But my view is always to remember not those who are here at the end, for the end, to receive a piece of the prize and say, we were with you all along. And of course, the Quran mentions very clearly about a certain group of people who say, in times of hardship, that all you have offered us is hardship and difficulty. So we don't want to be with you. But in times of prosperity, they say, we were with you all along. So you know people, you know individuals, and so forth by their history. You can judge them based upon that. My message to you, my brothers and sisters and friends, is partly what was recited in the beginning by the recitation from Surah Insan by the brother. In it, he quoted the verse, وَيَبْعُونَ الْطَعَامَ عَلَى حُبِّهِ مِسْكِينًا وَيَتِيمًا وَأَسِيرًا. He talks about, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about, and they give food in spite of their love for the wealth that they've accumulated to the masakin, to the poor, to the orphan, and to the captive, to the prisoner. One of the organizations that my organization, Caged Prisoners, works very closely with is the Islamic Human Rights Commission. And we choose carefully who we work with. We will not work with organizations who have fallen into the trap of targeting or allowing or justifying the targeting of Muslim communities or other communities. We will not fall into the trap of working with organizations who themselves have been duped by the doublespeak of the government's Prevent program or the Contest 2 program or any other programs that have been instituted by a government that specifically target Muslim community. We're proud to say working with the Islamic Human Rights Commission is something that we hope will continue for a long while and that our bonds together will become greater for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and for the sake of justice. So, everybody knows, I think everybody knows or ought to know what has happened in Guantanamo, what has happened in the secret detention sites, what has happened in the name of defending freedom, we have removed people's freedoms. And indeed, in this country, we have lost so many of our freedoms since the implementation of the various anti-terror legislations and measures introduced after September the 11th. We've seen in this country, in the United Kingdom of Great Britain, the land of habeas corpus, where no man is supposed to be detained without charge or trial, where this concept was exported to the rest of the world in order to try to civilize it, that people cannot be put in prison without being told what it is that they have done. We've seen all of this take place and change even to the point here in the United Kingdom. There is a unit, an entire detainee unit in Evesham, in the prison of HMP, Her Majesty's Prison, Longbarton, where there are men who have been held, in some cases, for more than 12 years. No charge, no trial, no explanation. either on extradition orders now or on deportation orders and awaiting some sort of justice. These people, many of whom have fled their countries in order to seek asylum into the United Kingdom, now are trying to seek asylum from the United Kingdom. They are saying, "Oh Allah, give you refuge from Britain." Not in Britain, from Britain. Because what Britain has done to them. There are individuals who were slitting their own wrists trying to get out of this country. There are other individuals who, knowing that they would be tortured if they were returned to their countries of origin, chose to do so rather than to face the humiliation of being held in this country incommunicado or indefinitely for a period of time that they cannot quantify. And I've seen numerous non-Muslim individuals and organizations working ardently and diligently for the rights and justice of these people. Seven of them are sitting here proudly with us today. But we as the Muslim community continue to lag and to lag behind in issues that concern us first and foremost. When we see experts talking about issues that we are experts in because we live them every single day on the television, we see those experts talking about us, writing books about us, producing academic studies about us. Where's our voice? Where is our voice? Where is it quoted that we are the ones who are speaking on our behalf?
How are you all doing? Having a nice time? Yes, alhamdulillah. It's nice to be here again. We performed here maybe twice, but the last time was about 4 years ago. And we're very happy to be here on this very serious occasion, very serious night. And so we was actually sitting down and planning about, you know, what can we perform that can reflect what's going on and what people are talking about. Okay, so we're going to do a few songs. And I think the first one we could do, don't worry, we can actually share this mic. We used to perform it with one mic sometimes. Even one time we performed with a computer mic, remember? Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah, it's coming. And the first one we're going to do is called Don't Diss the Prophet, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Because we know that when people were talking about disrespecting the Prophet, we thought, what can we do to show our love for the Prophet? So we made this song called Don't Diss the Prophet. I hope that you enjoy it.
Yes. Okay. The microphones are a bit too high, forgive me.
Okay, what we can do, we'll just share this one, it's a better sound.
Okay.
Okay.
All right.
And it goes,
don't diss the prophet.
Don't disrespect. Reflect before you say what your mind regrets.
Come on.
Don't diss the prophet in the meter or the pulpit. His life and his deeds you see under the carpet. Don't diss the prophet. Don't disrespect. Reflect before you say what your mind regret. Come on, don't diss the prophet in the meter or the pulpit. His life by the Jesus seen under the carpet.
In response to the dunce articles, statements and cartoons, with the fake prophet Muhammad with this tune, depicted with negativity in society out of order. You don't know his manners and you don't know his character. He showed love to his foes and adversaries, initiating race relations, respecting ladies, worshipping what God in peace. Was his consensus, salutations to Moses, Mary and Jesus. For that truthful, humble and trustworthy, here to set the record straight, no controversy. Written in the gospel, Torah, book of Isaiah, purification of the self was his desire. He never taught in the suffering of children, home or abroad, only submitted to the will of his Lord. Some Muslims give him a bad name and shame, the walking Quran came to heal the pain. Don't diss the prophet, don't disrespect. Reflect before you say what your mind regret. Come on, don't diss the prophet in the meter or the pulpit. His life when his deeds just sweep under the carpet. Don't diss the prophet, don't disrespect. Reflect before you say what your mind regret. Come on, don't diss the prophet in the meter or the pulpit. His life and his deeds just sweep under the carpet.
Don't diss the prophet, come off it. You need to stop it. It's not worth it. Creating enmity for profit and for status. We're dealing with the man who was the greatest of our man. Hated by the hypocrites and the haters. No pictures of the prophet had nothing photographic. We don't worship man, we worship you, it's terrific. The one who sent him to the universe, the same one who blessed me. then they will convert. If you disrespect the Prophet, your enemies of Allah.
Wallahi.
If you do that, there's no protector.
Aywa.
The Prophet Muhammad, the beloved, worldwide, his name glorified, inner soul purified. If you disrespect the Prophet Muhammad, that's
evil.
That acts for evil.
You cause upheaval.
He's the most of man toward the planet Earth. Blessed by angels. Blessed was the day of his birth.
Come on, don't diss the Prophet. Don't disrespect. Reflect before you say what your mind will regret. Come on, don't diss the Prophet. He'll beat you with a pumping. His life and his deeds are sweet under the carpet. Don't diss the Prophet. Don't disrespect. Reflect before you say what your mind will regret. Come on, don't diss the Prophet. He'll beat you with a pumping. His life and his deeds are sweet under the carpet. This is for the preachers, teachers, and journalists, directors, theologians.
What are teachers in the meet?
They might diss the Prophet
on a regular basis.
Yes, we have to counteract this. I do my research with urgent zest. Check the bike of fit guide to goodness. Ashifa, known as the medication. When we learn about his life, every application.
Do you know him?
His name is Rasulullah, the key to Jannah.
The Prophet and beloved of Allah.
I want
they were the corrupt.
You
must be ill, need a counselor. We're dealing with the man that lived for justice. Don't disrespect the Prince of Righteousness. Come on.
Don't diss the Prophet. Don't disrespect. Reflect before you say what you might regret. Come on. Don't diss the Prophet. In the major of the part of his life and his needs to speak under the carpet.
Don't diss the Prophet. Don't disrespect. Reflect before you say what you might regret. Come on.
Manchester to the northwest, and that was really to fulfill my lifelong ambition of becoming a housewife. But before I started learning how to be a housewife, I spent many years hanging around at airports. No, it's not what you're thinking, let me explain. You see, I used to be an aid worker, and I spent many years, 8 years, flying around the world, sometimes twice a month. And every single time I go to the airport, I would, you know, have a bit of a nervous situation. I feel very anxious, I'm breaking into a sweat. And as we all know in this room, when we go to the airport, we're all treated as America's most wanted. It's not nice. You've got your body scanners, you've got your CCTV cameras, the random security searches. We all know, we've been there. So to help me get through this ordeal, I developed a mantra, and that was, act right and get on the flight. It usually worked. And I needed to chant this mantra to myself many, many times when I was asked to fly to Israel. I was working for Save the Children, and my colleagues in Jerusalem needed me, so I was asked to fly out. So I thought, well, okay, let's give it a go. So anyway, before I got to the airport, I decided to have a bit, you know, to basically develop a bit of a decoy outfit. Bit difficult when you wear a hijab. So anyway, I decided to put loads of makeup on my face and imitate an Al Jazeera newsreader. You know what I'm talking about, right? So lashes of makeup, I wore the highest heels I could find. You know, I'm one of these people, I very much believe in body language, and I thought, you know, when I'm interrogated, it might help if I'm towering over the interrogators. I don't know if that works, I'm sure the table over there can tell me. But anyway, so I arrived at Heathrow, and I go to the BA check-in desk, and the lady behind the counter tells me I've randomly, know the word random, been selected for an upgrade. Now, in all the years of flying around, I've never been upgraded. I thought, well, all right, the fun and games begin. So anyway, on my lovely flight to Israel, you know, I'm flying in the best seat. I decided to get some sleep. I knew it was going to be a long evening. So I arrive in Israel, and I'm met by a whole group of security guards. I nod at them, I say shalom, they nod back. So I go to passport control, I hand over my documents. The woman there looks at me, I look at her, she winks, I wink back. She then says, Miss Aziz, we have some questions for you. I said, no problem. She said, go over there, wait in the corner. So I wait in the corner. Anyway, wait in the corner for 20 minutes. Then eventually I'm called over. So I go over to see another woman. She says to me, what is your father's name? So I tell her my father's name is Abdulaziz. What is your father's father's name? I tell her, what is his father's father's name? I still got no idea. So then I was told to wait. So I wait, the clock's ticking, I'm waiting. I'm there for 2 hours, I'm there for 3 hours. Eventually, along come my interrogators. Now, I couldn't really take them very serious, and I'll tell you why. Good cop, he looked like Vladimir Putin. Seriously, he did. You can't take someone seriously that looked like Vladimir Putin. Bad cop, had to be an Arab. Looked like Kevin Keegan. He had the same bubblegum perm. So those high heels actually really helped. So anyway, Kevin Keegan looked at me and he sort of summoned me over. I thought, rightio, here we go. So I followed him, went into a room. Vladimir sat down first, then Kevin sat down. They told me to sit down, I sat down. Vladimir sat there peering at my face. Kevin started the interrogation. Now frankly, I can't make this up. And this is one of the reasons why I went into comedy, just because of all the escapades that happened to me. So this is the opening question in my interrogation, and I quote, Kevin Keegan says, who do you know in London? I said, sorry? Who do you know in London? I said, look, London is a major capital city. You're going to have to narrow that down a bit. Vladimir Putin didn't like that. His fist hit the table hard. He said, answer the question. I said, look, I can't really answer questions I don't really understand. Who do you think I might know in London? You got any names? You want to suggest some names to me? This didn't go down very well. Obviously, subtext, how many Al-Qaeda members do you know in London? So anyway, needless to say, this went on and on and on. So I said to Kevin, and I said to Vladimir, listen guys, this is not, we're not getting anywhere here, are we? I tell you what, I'm going to walk out, I'm going to go and sit over there, you lot decide what you want to do. They didn't like this. So off I trotted, sat down. I decided at this point, maybe I should ring my consulate in Tel Aviv and sort of try and ask them for some advice. So I called them. And some chap answered the phone, can't remember his name, let's just call him Cuthbert for now. So Cuthbert answers the phone, I said, look, hello there, British citizen, aid worker, I'm being asked all these questions. He says, Shaista, you know what the Israelis are like. I said, look, I don't really care if they want to ask me questions, that's fine, but I object very strongly to being asked questions about who do I know in London and all these other leading questions. Anyway, to add insult to injury, as I'm waiting to be interrogated, about three easy jet flights full of clubbers have arrived in Tel Aviv. So there's me sitting there, you know, aid worker, British passport holder, and I'm watching all these people walking through immigration control, being waved in, because I'm sure you know Israel is our holiday destination. Anyway, at this point, Kevin appears. Summons me over, so I walk over, I said yes. He says, have you remembered to tell us what you didn't tell us? I said, look, we're not getting anywhere with this. Anyway, this went on for another few hours, at which point I think they decided, you know, she's not cracking really, is she? She's a bit crackers, but she's not cracking. So then anyway, they take me to a whole another part of the building, and they told me it was a security area. So I'm sitting there while they ransack my bag and they're checking for everything and anything. So I just sat there and get on with it. I must tell you, I took great delight and pleasure in seeing these massive industrial sized bars of dairy milk that I actually bought for the team in Gaza. Requested chocolate because chocolate is a prohibited item in Gaza. You know, it's very dangerous as we all know. So anyway, the Israeli security officials spent 1 hour with the industrial-sized bars of dairy milk, and they went in and out of the machine. And I just thought, brilliant, the only democracy in the Middle East is getting chocolate. Someone ring Hamas and let them know. So, after all of this, they decided to chat to me some more, and they kept saying to me, can you tell us why we're not letting you in? I said, look, I don't pass caring now, let's just get on with it. So then they said, we're taking you to a detention centre. I said, right, so where is this detention centre? We can't tell you. I said, look, if you can't tell me where you're taking me, I'm not going. So eventually they told me they were taking me to a detention centre next to the airport. So I'm carted off into this vehicle. I arrive at the detention centre, and I'm told that the rules of the detention centre are, and I quote, you're not allowed any pens, because the pen is mightier than the sword. At that point, I had to laugh. And they told me I couldn't take my phone in, so obviously I told them what to do. And I told them there's no way I was going in, there's no way I was going to hand my phone over. So then they said to me, and I quote, do you want to be in a cell with other women? I said, look, do I look like I care? Anyway, they took me to a cell, they slammed the door. So there I was, contemplating the situation I was in. And I must say, it was very humbling actually, because as we all know, there's thousands and thousands of prisoners around the world, conscientious prisoners, political prisoners, who, you know, are detained. And then there's me, who's just locked up for a few hours. But I must say, the graffiti in Israel isn't up to scratch. I was looking around the cell and someone had scribbled something along the lines of, the police in Israel are really bad. I mean, you know, if you've got a pen, you should sort of try a bit harder as far as I'm concerned. Anyway, the following morning, one thing I forgot to tell you, and this is, again, you simply can't make this up. In the middle of the night, my mother decides to call me. Poor, long-suffering woman. So she said, I've been trying to ring you. I had like one bar of battery on my phone. So I said, look, Mum, I'm in a bit of a difficult situation here. Because can you speed up the conversation? She said, what's happened? I said, well, they've detained me, haven't they? She said to me, this is not their country. You tell them what to do. You tell them that you are not leaving. And I want you to stay there. And I want you to fight for a right to stay there. I said, look, Mum, let's just leave this, please. So I think this sort of gives you an idea of the sort of DNA in my family. So in the middle of the night, as I'm contemplating my fate, thinking about the situation that befalls Palestinians every single day, I get a blast of Iraqi resistance songs in my ears. My husband has decided to record Iraqi resistance songs on my iPod, which he very conveniently packed for me without telling me. So I thought that was quite amusing. Anyway, in the morning I get a knock on the door. Are you ready to leave? I said yes. And I said, look, where am I going? So I thought, better check. I said, you do know I'm British, don't you? Yes, we know you're British. Yes, we know you're British. Anyway, I'll tell you what my trauma really kicked in. My trauma kicked in when I discovered that I was being flown home on EasyJet. And I think I'll leave it there for now.
Now, this African mission has come a long way since 97. We've not only been a trusted authority to the problems in the community, but also the communities is, you know, it's coming to us increasingly over the years to come for, you know, to seek support. Now we have the United Nations, the OSCE, the British Home Office and police coming to us as a trusted source for the community. Now we have individuals, over 50,000 individuals following us worldwide. Our status, we're a charity, a company, and we're accredited by the United Nations. We're funded by individuals like yourself. Every penny helps. Every single penny helps. We have individuals who are in American prison, who work inside the prison, and the little they do, they donate to us on a monthly basis. This is what makes IHRC run every day. And you'd be surprised that the work of IHRC is run on the backbone of no more than 50 individuals at a time. So around the world, we have 15 staff volunteers in headquarters in the UK. We have over 150 campaigners in more than 60 different countries. 25 active campaigns, 200 cases that cover approximately, set staff for 350 individuals, 63 researchers and monitors. And we are growing. Now, over the years, over the past decade or so, we've had some milestones in the work that we've done. In 1998, we've campaigned for Zaki, release of 1999, release of Malatya 75, 2000, exposing extended Islamophobia and Muslim hate crimes, 2001, Durban Anti-Racism Conference, 2004, reports there's Muslim experience and expectations of citizenship, gender, law, media, discrimination, and education. 2005, ending Oxfam's association with Starbucks. 2006, judicial review of UK permission to allow flights to aid Israel 11 and more. 2006, against Science and Jewish Perspectives conference. 2008, expose mistreatment of Muslim Roma in Bulgaria. 2009, Mahsa Satrari released. Now, what really drew me to IHRC was when I first started in 2006. When we extensively worked on a campaign of Mirza Tahir Hussein. Now this brother was in a Pakistani prison for 18 years.
He was facing the death penalty, but in 18 years, the British government did nothing, nothing at all. Despite the fact that this individual was a soldier in the Territorial Army, 18 years down the line, his brother comes up to us, you know, asks for assistance. Alhamdulillah, his brother is free now, and he has learned to start his life, starting up his family. So why is this work important? And there's an array of hands from the audience that show, you know, they've been discriminated against. But the discrimination that we face, you know, is far worse in some other places around the world. So just to name a few topics of why it's so important to carry out the work that we're doing at IHRC. Anti-Muslim sentiment is growing. Muslims are seen as perpetrators, not victims. Muslims are increasingly alienated, prejudice, discrimination, harassment and hate crimes. Global hotspots such as Gaza and the Balkans, and Muslims fighting non-Muslims, non-Muslims fighting Muslims, and vice versa. And to our shock, there is no reliable source of the monitoring statistics that have been gathered by any organization extensively. So we can't use the information that we have to kind of fight our cause. There's poor influence on decision and policy here all over the place, so disunited. And we have poor and limited media representation. Now, the impact that we're having is on the individuals who are being oppressed. But we don't want you to be oppressed. We don't want you to be the next victim. That is what we're trying to avoid. We're here trying to help individuals from being victims of what's happening out there.
That those who stand up for the need of their brothers, when there is no one else around to stand up for them, then Allah will be for them when there is no one else to stand up for them. Those who stand up for their brothers and for justice of their brothers is like our mujahid. There is not much opportunity for us to become mujahid other than these aspects. We could actually become linked to the struggle, the international struggle for justice that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded us to be part of. And this is our way. This is the minimum that we have to do. And so I would like to invite you to actually rise up to the challenge, to the verse of Quran that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, how could you not rise up and fight for the sake of those oppressed men, women and children who are crying and saying, Ya Allah, send us a helper. Ya Allah, send us a protector. That is actually a call to every single one of us. And that is why we're doing it. That is why we do these things. Yesterday, I received a text message from a brother from Yemen who once was being forced to be sent back to Yemen. When his whole family, five members of his family were sent back from other parts of Europe and they were killed. One of them within 48 hours his body was handed over to his family after he was refused political asylum in Holland. And we campaigned with the Home Office and we created the environment. We wrote reports and professional statements for his support. And he called, he sent a text message that yesterday he actually was given permission to leave, to remain. And he was thanking me, and he was thanking all of us at IHRC. In reality, he was thanking every single one of you who have actually helped to create and to support the Islamic Human Rights Commission. So I tell you, thank you on behalf of all those we have helped. All those statistics, I would like to thank you and invite you to be more part of this and continue to be part of that. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.